How come you went into the British Army anyway when you were...
Well, I had an elder brother. There was five of us, actually. Five brothers. We all served in the 1914-18 war. And the eldest fella, he was a long-headed guy, you know. When we'd be reading Anderson's fairy tales, he'd be reading the Hansworth History of the World. And he was always on about, what a wonderful world it was out there, and see the world and all this kind of thing, see? Well, the only way we could see the world was if somebody extra Spence joined the army. He finished up, he was Battery Sergeant Major B Battery, the Royal Canadian Horse Artillery. Joe, he was the second eldest brother, he was a machine gunner of the Irish Guards. And Pat, he was in the Royal Engineers, he was blown up at Vimy Ridge. Frank, he was in the Royal Dublin Fusiliers, he was killed at Moreland Court on the Somme. He was killed in the morning time, and I got gassed at the same place on the same day, in the evening.
Same day.
Yeah. So the only way to see the world and see all these wonderful things that the elder brother used to be talking about was join the army.
You told a lie, Jack.
I did.
You said you were 18.
Yeah.
And you were only 16.
I know that. Well, that's the only way I could get into the army. It wasn't me that really thought that up. It was a sergeant named MacDonald, a very smart-looking man who was a recruiting sergeant in Brunswick Street in Dublin. And he said, well, he said, jack your age up, all that kind of thing. He said, and you'll be able to pass all right. So I did. So I had an army age and I had another age, you see, so that's it.
You never had any idea what you were getting into, Jack, did you?
Well, I thought I was going to see the world, but I damn near seen the second world, the other world.
Yeah. How deep were trenches?
10, 12 feet.
Deep?
Yeah.
And you
because you had a head cover.
Yes.
And then there was the steps for getting up and going over the top.
Yes. And tell me about going over the top. I'm told that the men shouted when they were going over the top. When
you shouted because, I'm going to tell you something, Kay. I never went over the top that I wasn't scared. I was scared stiff. And everyone shouted because more or less we were all scared. And you shouted because it kind of helped you.
Yeah.
See? And you shouted all the way until you got into action.
And they were shooting at you all the time?
Oh, yes. The shells were bursting, the bullets were flying, you hear the whine of the bullets and the bursting of the shell and all that kind of thing.
And how bad was it? Tell me about the wet and the smell.
Look, yeah, I am an old Contemptible, as you know. I'm the only one in Ireland. The 1940, let me say this much, Gay. I think myself, it's my opinion, that the British Army that went overseas in August 1914 was up till then the finest army the world has ever seen. Surely we proved it in 1914 and the winter of 1914-15. Huh? We weren't living actually in the sense of the word. It was just punishment. Can you imagine yourself standing out there in all kind of weather, hail, rain, frost and snow? Any bit of food you got, you ate a cold minded, that's another thing. If you had a bit of food you were saving for a rainy day, the only safe place for it was in your stomach. There's the rats that find it no matter where you put one. Mm. What with the lice eating the flesh off the live ones and the rats scourging themselves on the bodies of the dead, it was a lovely, real happy time, wasn't it?
And how far away would the bodies of the dead be from where?
They'd be all around you. You see, as the lads got killed, you couldn't bury them right away because if you tried to try and bury them right away, that was an easy target for the jerrys and you'd finish up one of them. So you had to wait until the proper time when you had the real, real chance of saving your life to bury them.
And meanwhile, they lay there?
They lay there for weeks sometime. Don't know, it could be a friend of yours, it could be a relative of yours, but the rat's gorging them. And you standing there looking at them through a loophole, standing on the fire step.
And
well, I tell you, it was just sheer punishment. There's a lot of people don't know it, but we went hungry in the early days, the early days of trench warfare.
Yeah.
Now, of course, from Mons on to the Somme, on to the Yen, it was all open warfare. Mm. See?
But you went hungry in the trenches.
We went hungry. Now, it wasn't to any fault of our supply columns. I'll tell you how it happened. If in the evening time the shelling wasn't too heavy, we could hear the transport behind the German lines, you know, moving around and coming up with the supplies for the trenches and the rations for the lads, see? And, of course, they could hear ours. Well, it seemed to be that it was a signal for the artillery on both sides to open up and blow them off the roads. Too damned often they were successful, with the result that 9 or 10 o'clock at night, the word had come along, sorry, lads, no rations tonight, transport couldn't get through. Well, now, I think that actually died away by mutual consent, Because if the lads in the trenches couldn't get food and they couldn't get the munitions and supplies they wanted, what was going to happen? And it gradually died out. And after that, supplies were pretty regular.
So you didn't shell their supply trains and they didn't shell yours?
No, it died out. What were you going to do with the men in the trenches if they couldn't get food or couldn't get the equipment?
Yes. And did the rats attack you in the trenches where you were?
There was one thing, Gay, you come to mention that we had to be very careful of, not to leave any wounded out. Get the wounded in, get them in somewhere where they could be, because the rats have been known to attack helpless wounded. They could be alive, but the rats would attack them. As a matter of fact, there was one night, we were out of the line at the time, and we were in an old loft. And a young lad I knew very well, he was lying alongside me this night sleeping, he woke up and he was shouting, he'd been bit. Well, we lit a bit of candle, and right enough, a rat had taken a piece out of his cheek. So we put a force field dressing on, and the normal time he'd seen the doctor. Now, it just shows you how poisonous they were. In 2 days' time, that young lad was dead, and his head and neck and that had swelled up and gone black. So it just shows you the poison in the rat bite. I often wondered how many Tommies really got killed by rat bite. Because they were there, there were millions. There were millions. There were everywhere. Now, that's something I'd like to tell you, Kay. I got gassed when my brother got killed the same day on the Somme, up in Marlincourt on the Somme. Well, I think I went grey-haired overnight worrying would I be permanently blind. I'll tell you how I got gassed in the first instance. We were on a working party this day, see? Bringing stuff up to the line of that. And Jerry twigged us and he put over a shell barge. Now, there was no gas around. I had my gas mask on, hung over my right shoulder, and the gas mask was down here on my left hip. And during the barge, I got a smack in the hip. It was a real hard one because it knocked me into a trench hole about 6 feet away. But right away, I had my pants down to see where I was wounded. But I wasn't wounded, no blood or anything like that, see? Never gave it a thought. Carried on that day. And now that night, there was a bunch of us in an old, disused German gun emplacement because we'd driven the Germans back, you see. And an officer came along. He said, "Hey, lads," he said, "there's 10 or 12 men out there," he said, "wounded. Go out and bring them in." So, of course, right away, we went out to get the wounded in. Now, when we went out, Jerry put over gas shells. Of course, as soon as you sniff the gas, everyone shouted, "Put on your gas mask, lads." Well, I put on my gas mask and that kind of thing, the same as everybody would. And I hadn't it on about 2 minutes. And I began to get sick into my gas mask, you know. Then my ears began to pain me, and I began to find it difficult to breathe. So I either pull the plastic thing off or suffocate. So I pulled it off, of course, scattered around for a while and went down. Luckily, a lad came along just as I went down, and he said, "Where are you hit, mate?" So I said, "I'm not hit, I'm certain gassed." And as he bent down to help me, he said, "No wonder you're gassed, mate." He said, "There's a big piece of German shell in the metal container of your gas mask. That's what hit me early on the day."
That's what hit you.
So, of course, God, I never felt so bad. Oh, my eyes, my throat, everything like that. Well, anyway, another lad came along between them that took me down to the casualty clearing station. It was only just a little way down the reserve trenches. Mm. Now, I remember the medical officer coming on there and taking my particulars from my identity disc. But I must have been unconscious for a long time because I don't remember anything else until I was in the 2nd Canadian General Hospital down at Leigh Threeport. That was right down on the coast. Mm. And I said, "Where am I?" And somebody said, "We're in the 2nd Canadian General Hospital at Leigh Threeport, see?" Well, I must have been unconscious all that time. And it took days for me to come to the front line right down there. Well, anyway, there was a medical officer came to see me. So he said, "How long have you been out here?" So I said, "Since August 1914, sir." So he said, "Where do you come from?" So I said, "Marlincourt on the Somme." "No," he said, "I don't mean where you come from. Where's your home?" I said, "My parents live in Dublin." Well, I remember nothing after that. But I was getting shaken around a bit, and I asked where I was, and a man's voice said, "You're at the North Wall in Dublin." Well, now, I'd come all the way from the 2nd Canadian General and been put on a Red Cross convoy and all that to Dublin. So I must have been unconscious all that time.
Until you got back to Dublin.
But anyway, I finished up in a hospital in Dublin Castle. It was a private hospital. And
looking back on it now, Jack, it was all senseless, wasn't it? Or do you think it was senseless? What's your attitude to it now?
Well, my attitude to it now, I know, how is this for loyalty? In 1915, when things began to get good, you know, we were getting reinforcements out and things like that, you see, those of us who had been out for months got a 7 days leave. That was 7 days leave from the time you left the trenches until you returned to the trenches. Now, how is this for loyalty? Of all the lads in the unit that got that 7 days leave, I was one of them. Every one of them was back within the 7 days. There wasn't one deserted, although that every opportunity to deserted. That's loyalty.
To your pals.
That's
your
loyalty to your oath.
To your oath.
Mm. And to your pals. Mm.
And you never thought of deserting or anything like that, or making a run for it?
Never entered my head, and I don't suppose it entered anybody else's head.
And do you ever think now of the Germans that you shot, Jack?
Did they what?
Do you ever think of the Germans you shot now?
No, certainly not. What do you think? It was dead, kill or be killed. You killed them or they killed you, one or the other. What the hell? It was just a game. War is war, Gay. You kill or be killed. No, you've no remorse for anything like that.
You were just in it up to your ears and that was it.
You were just doing what you took the oath to do. Mm. Mm. Without favour or affection, malice or ill will. Huh?
Nothing personal.
Oh, boy. No, nothing.